Good afternoon. I'm Bob Rubin. I'm co-chair emeritus of the Council of Foreign Relations, and it is my enormous privilege to welcome an old personal friend to the Council today, Prime Minister of Malaysia, Anwar Ibrahim. The discussion will be held, or rather be moderated, by Mariko Silver, President and CEO of the Luce Foundation, and a new member of the Council's board. In accordance with the practices of the Council, I'm not going to read from his resume, but I think you have it in your materials. In any event, it is enormously distinguished and highly respected resume, and enormously distinguished and highly respected individual. I want to make a few personal comments. I first met Anwar Ibrahim roughly mid-90s, I would say it was. And that was a time, as you may remember, of the Asian, well, it was time leading into the Asian financial crisis. And Anwar became a friend and a colleague. We at the Treasury had enormous respect for Anwar Ibrahim. As I said a moment ago, we really viewed him, even though he was a finance minister of another country, as a colleague of ours. And he was enormously helpful to us as we tried to think our way through the difficulties of the Asian financial crisis. So when Mike Froman, the new president of the council, asked me if I would introduce Anwar Ibrahim, I was really deeply, deeply honored to do so. And we just chatted for a little while and reminiscent about those days, now 30 years ago, I guess, Anwar. As all of you know, he has courageously stood for pluralism, for democracy and reform in Malaysia at immense personal cost. And his wife and daughter carried on while he was falsely incarcerated. Today, as Prime Minister, Anwar Ibrahim continues to be a powerful force in Malaysia for democracy and pluralism, the values to which he has dedicated his life. The Prime Minister is a longstanding and greatly valued friend of the Council. He's spoken here many times. And so we are enormously grateful to welcome back the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Anwar Ibrahim, and Rico, who will conduct the discussion.
Thank you, Secretary Rubin, for that introduction, and welcome, Prime Minister. We'll now have, as is the Council tradition, about 25 minutes of conversation before opening it up to questions from CFR members, both in the room and online. Prime Minister, you recently described your dream for Malaysia, and I'm sure you could do it better than I, but I'll quote you if you'll forgive me. You said, "I want Malaysia to evolve as an example of a free society, a just multiracial society, to preach humanity and compassion. That would depend largely on our ability to govern fairly and justly. I believe that with a strong sense of conviction and tenacity of purpose, we'll be able to bring Malaysia to the fore." Now, just last week, you announced a new five-year development agenda. What in this new plan is going to help Malaysia turn the corner and realize that dream?
Thank you, Dr. Silva. I mean, since Bob Rubin is here, I must recognize his presence as a dear friend, dear colleague, who showed so much compassion and care in those difficult years. He was an outstanding Secretary of Treasury from major economy, but he was so considerate, kind, and even for relatively smaller economies like Malaysia, he took us as a friend, listened quite a bit. And the only problem with America, everybody hectors, nobody listens. But I see there's an exception. Bob Rubin listened very well, tried to understand our predicament. Thank you, Bob. And all those years when I was assigned to the teaching at Georgetown University, he knew my background, my predicament, and he, with friends like Jim Wolfenson, who take an extra effort to contact CFR and to make sure that I'm quite involved and with the support he gave. Thank you very much. Now, I was here at the time of the, prior to the financial crisis, or at the beginning. Malaysia was not affected, but it was mainly Thailand, the Thai baht crisis, and Indonesia. And I think Morris Greenberg moderated the session. And I got into a lot of trouble because of that speech in 97. I started by saying, quoting Spitzer, a gale of creative destruction. Why can't we in Asia use that period to rebuild, to correct the flaws and weaknesses in the system, particularly issue of governance, issue of corruption, issue of faulty policies. And then I told the story. My colleague, Malaki, was then Minister of Finance of Indonesia. And there was the time of the Titanic. So I said, I met him, I said, Malaki, why don't you spend a bit of time, relax, and watch the Titanic? He said, Anwar, why do I need to watch the Titanic? I am in the Titanic. So I said, what's the problem? He said, I told the captain, slow down, sir. We're going to crash. The captain says, no, our fundamentals are strong. We go full steam ahead. And that was the disaster for Indonesia. So I cited that. This was related to the then boss of mine, Prime Minister. And he said, Anwar used the CFR to attack the Prime Minister. And the rest is history. I was incarcerated for some years. And CFR was partly responsible. Now back to your question, Dr. Silver. I think what is important, particularly for those who have undergone some tribulations and trials in life, I always relate my experience with Madiba, with Mandela. Soon after I was released, many times I was released, but it's particularly it was 2004. He invited me, Aziza, and the family to visit him in Joburg. And he was very relaxed, cheerful. And they started looking at my children. And immediately he changed. He looked very disturbed, sad, and was teary. And he said, Anwar, we must be crazy. And no wonder some people consider us mad. So I tried to get him to relax a bit. I said, look, Madiba, yours was a long walk to freedom. Mine is a short walk to freedom. And we are certainly not mad, but I agree with you. We must be really crazy to do what we had to do. I think that should suffice as the answer.
But you didn't talk about Madani and you didn't talk about the economic development plan. So let's spend a little time on that.
Yeah. No, now, of course, we are in the position. I mean, I've waited some years, worked hard. And interesting enough, we had a coalition, very committed colleagues, who understands that Malaysia can evolve and emerge as a great economy, working model for a pluralistic society, peace, through peace, compassion, and harmony. With, of course, with a clear vision for the country. So we call it the Madani framework. What's different in the Madani economic framework? Of course, you talk about sustainability, you talk about the changes and now digital transformation, renewable energy and greed, fair. But what is lacking to my mind, particularly for humanity now, is that when people are so engrossed and obsessed about development, there's little concern about issues affecting humanity, which requires compassion. I mean, religion, race are being used to create mischief and hatred and enmity. To my mind, the relevance of religion, or for the matter of state and governance, is to create a better understanding and tolerance. Not necessarily to forget, I remain a Muslim, I'm a practicing Muslim. But there's nothing in religion which should be exploited to sow the seed of hatred. As you have seen, the growing fascism in the Europe, the far right here, which of course is concerning for countries like us. So that is why we have to craft a policy, but also tied to the dictates of the time, the zeitgeist, with the digital technology and green and renewable energy. we have to address this because they are the new realities which we did not discuss in the 1990s. There was not the central focus in the 1990s.
So you talked about green transition, energy transition. The plan also talks about AI and smart tech industrial sectors. Talk to me a little bit about the role of foreign investment that you see in all of this, and particularly how you're going to weigh partnerships with the US, partnerships with China. I'm sure you anticipated this question, and I'm sure you have an answer.
You know, Malaysia in the 90s did relatively well because we are a trading nation. We work through FTAs, and we were able to attract investments, particularly in the United States. United States was the leading investor in the country. Even today, when we have improved trade and more investment from China, but the total investments into Malaysia today is still from the United States. And we have benefited immensely because United States companies, though tough negotiations, but in terms of training, in terms of transfer technology, I mentioned Dell this morning, for example, in terms of research center, other than in California, it is in Malaysia, the largest training and research outfit outside of the United States. So we cannot affect change and propel the economy without attracting investments. Of course, by suggesting attracting investments, which means that we have to make the necessary adjustments, the incentives and the ease of doing business, and facing fierce competition from our neighbors, we need to do and surpass that. I think reasonably, we are rather successful, in many ways more successful, because when Tesla decided to move in, and AWS, Amazon, has come in with huge investments, even in Europe, Infineon with 5 billion euros, all are recent decisions which is required for this country. Now, how do you balance this with China? To us, it is not it's not a zero-sum game as far as we see it from the perspective of a small developing country. China happens to be a neighbor, a close neighbor, and the largest investor into Malaysia, and huge trading within Malaysia. United States have been a very loyal, traditional friend. We share many common values in terms of democracy, human rights, and me personally, as I've said this morning, all the administrations from Clinton to Bush, they've been very supportive and outspoken in terms of defending my period of my tribulations. So I, of course, and I'm too many friends, Senate, the Congress, the administration, and of course the various think tanks, and of course CFR. So we need to then utilize this to the benefit of our country now. The exchanges that I've had with China, of course, with Xi Jinping, of course, quite formal, but with Premier Li Qiang, it's been 3 times since he took over office as Prime Minister and me. And that means a lot of very serious, intimate, frank discussion sessions. And that has helped immensely. Kamala Harris was in Jakarta and during dinner, because these questions were raised. And I said, contrary to general perception, we need China and contain as a neighbor, as a trading partner. But the United States is an important traditional ally. Now, how do we manage that? We manage as a small country. I can't change the world, but I can at least assure them that we will continue with that sort of relationship to the benefit of both. Hopefully, things can subside. The tension is now creating anxiety in the region. And South China Sea is one issue. I raised in front of Li Qiang in a public forum in Jakarta. I said, Malaysia has to be firm, this is our territory. Petronas is involved in some of the oil rigs. And he responded. I was certainly pleased with his response. Number one, he said, of course, they have their claims too, but they will not resort to any aggressive action or violence. They will insist on series of negotiations, which I see is fair. And I think when this the response was that in Jakarta, that was certainly helpful. I met him again after that, the last few days in Nanning, and we pursued some of the issues. And let's see from there.
So let's turn to domestic politics for a moment. You have a big dream for Malaysia. You have a vision honed over many years of what you want Malaysia's position to be in the world, and also what you envision for Malaysia itself internally. There was recently an election, as I'm sure you know, and your coalition didn't come out so well. Was that a green wave? Was it an expression of some other realm of discontent? How do you read that election and what it tells you about what the impediments are going to be for you to realize this vision?
Dr. Silver, with your impeccable credentials in the academia, you understand that dealing with the the proponents of racism and religious bigotry is not easy. And we have to deal with this. But we need to sustain the level of support. The three important, vibrant, economically vibrant states, we won. Simply, we should not win. I mean, don't expect in democracy you should win all. I mean, and gives us some sense of humility not to think that you're all powerful and popular. So you should lose some. That I learned from Bob, I think. But we did sustain the three important economically vibrant states. And the last two by-elections in the South, there was concern, of course, whether the so-called green wave of the Islamic Party and the Malay-based Party would be able to then gain or garner more support. No, they lost. They lost rather badly. So I think we are now comfortable for the next 4 years. We'll be around.
So other than humility, what message do you take?
Well, we'll have to deal with this rise, as you know, in Europe, often here, fascism and xenophobia and even some extreme appeals for religious support. We'll have to then communicate more effectively. We have learned that you can't assume talking about Madani and economic advancement and lowering inflation to 2%, lowering unemployment, getting huge investments, new investments coming in. That does not necessarily impact upon the sentiments of the rural folks. So you need to engage them to reassure them that they will continue to be protected as Malays, as Muslims in the country. But also to educate them, look, in Islam or the survival of the Malays does not mean that you should cultivate policies and try and ignore and marginalize the rest. No country will be stable and effective if you continue to try and discriminate, marginalize any segment of your population. So I think it is important to understand, to then communicate effectively to them, to say that, yes, Malaysia, majority of Malaysians are Muslims and Malays. Yes, Islam is the religion of the Federation. Yes, Malay is the official language. But yes, we have to then accept the presence of our brothers and sisters, the ethnic Chinese and the Indians, the Hindus, the Buddhists, the Christians, as part of a Malaysian family. And that is not as easy because even in a more sophisticated, highly educated society in the United States, you have to grapple with these issues. But we cannot give up. And I believe that with this sort of agenda and to focus on economic fundamentals and growth, we'll be able to deal with this.
And it's work that's never done. And it seems like there is some real realignment happening in Malaysian politics among the parties. Can you talk a little bit about that and what you think is driving that realignment, other than personalities, right, from the point of view of policy?
Yeah, the alignment is at the, with the former ruling party, UMNO, the dominant party for a long time. I've been fighting against them for two decades, and now they're an important partner. So my friends, some of them quite cynical. They say, I know, must make some deals and some compromises. Yeah, compromise, yes, but what deals? Good governance, ridding the country of corruption, more transparent in the way of doing business, and all shared by my coalition partners, including Sabah and Sarawak. So if these parameters are accepted, then we can move. Of course, there are concerns, there are cynicism. I think I would accept it's not easy, but what choice do we have? Can we can continue to govern with this factional strife and enmity? I've suffered in monastery. Colleagues know. I mean, 10 and a half years of solitary confinement is not easy feat. But we're not talking about Anwar here. You're talking about nation and the future of the country. And if you can then garner enough force and agree on basic parameters, then we can move. And I think it is exceptionally important because Malaysia is a Muslim majority country and there is a democracy deficit in these countries. And but we can, if we have a clear vision and work together, prove that there's nothing stopping a Muslim majority country to emerge as a viable, mature democracy, justice, compassion, and embracing in an inclusive manner, all communities. Is it easy? No, it's not. But do you then give up? No. I think many in the past have proven to be true. I always quote Alexis Tocqueville's Democracy in America about the habits of the heart. You see, it takes a smart French philosopher to tell the story about American democracy, but it worked. I mean that I should say assessment or analysis of the history of American dream taught me a great thing about the need to inculcate values, understanding, passion, because only through the habits of the heart you can ensure that there is meaning to democracy, development, growth.
Well, I would agree with that. And can you give us your clear vision for the bottom 40 and for fighting corruption in Malaysia?
Well, if you set the parameters right, it's not easy. Everybody talks about war against the corrupt. But if you launch this battle, you're dealing with a very strong country of very, very corrupt elements, and they are very powerful. Many of them control government apparatus, business, the media. So it's not easy feat. But it takes some crazy people to deal with this. And I think I've been relatively successful. Importantly, the leadership must set an example. Uncompromising, impeccable credentials, no nonsense approach, they are prepared to take the bull by the horn. And, well, they say, what with the past? The past, this has limitations. But what do I do with the past? What I can do is under this administration, I'm proud to say that in my tenure as Prime Minister for the last 9 months, with a very close scrutiny by the Anti-Corruption Commission, by the Commercial Crime, by the Central Bank, they have not found any sort of excesses. If I have incontrovertible facts and evidence to suggest, I have made it very clear to my colleagues, we have to remove them.
What about the bottom 40? Talk about a little bit more about your economic vision for the bottom 40.
Well, the first time I was arrested and detained under the Internal Security Act for 2 years without trial, it was because I championed the cause of the poor. Now, unlike the socialists, they talk about equality, but shared poverty. I think we need to share wealth, which means that we have to have concrete policies to generate income and revenue for the country through investments, right? Only then, but with a clear policy, the Madani means is not growth for the ruling clique and elites. But you have to do that then to be able to use that to effect change, starting with education, access, democratization of access to quality education, public health, and poverty. I have said that this year, 2023, another crazy idea. I said, I want to be a country in Malaysia that would deal and settle with zero abject poverty. Not poverty, poverty, of course, takes time. But we have a category as abject poverty will deal. Not one family should fall to this category. Okay? Then we deal higher up. Because in terms of productivity and wage, we have this gap. You know, the productivity increase, but the wage does not increase tandem with productivity. But do I push that now? No. I can only push that when we have some comfortable growth and better investments through pragmatic policies. But Silver believed that I'm not suggesting it was not done. It was done even in the past. And to be fair, the amount of money disbursed for the poor is enormous. But too many leakages, okay? So this needs to be corrected. But the priority to alleviate the problem of the poor. I mean, I give a small example, which is, of course, not too much of a concern here in the United States. I took over, then I said, look, what about our schools? Now, most of the schools here have rotten lavatories. You know, you have a school of 2,000 students, 8 lavatories, 4 not functioning. And throughout the country, we have that problem. It sounds very simple. It's not something that the Prime Minister should be dealing with, but I did. We found out that there are 840 schools in the country don't have proper lavatories. And we had to spend 1 billion ringgit to do that. And I would say that by October, all the 840 schools, mainly urban poor and rural poor, have resolved, including some remote areas in Sarawak. So it's a good example how we deal with the issue of poverty.
Step by step, small policy, big policy.
Yes.
So now I think it's time for us to take some questions from the audience. I will start with a question from the room and then we'll go to Zoom.
I feel a bit nervous and embarrassed because Bob is here. I have, you know, with us, Generation Bob, I admire you greatly. I mean, what you have done, your policies and the friendship. So forgive me for, you know, looking a bit too confident.
Thank you first.
Mr. Prime Minister, my name is Christopher Weary, and I serve here on the council as a visiting military fellow from the United States Army. So my question is simple. If you could provide some perspective, what can Malaysia's friends, partners, allies, both in and out of the region, do better in the Indian Ocean, Strait of Malacca, and South China Sea to ensure it remains free and open?
Our position, the centrality of ASEAN, is that we should resolve that within the region. Of course, we engage with the United States in terms of the joint operations, military operations. Malaysia is quite active with the United States. And that's not affect our relations with China. We said, look, it's been traditionally our ally, and the operations, joint operations have been going on. I think the last 2-3 months, there were 5 operations, small scale operations. We do have to excite the Chinese unnecessarily. But to see that sort of friendship will continue. But as I've said to leaders in the administration here, and countries like Australia, and recently President Trudeau of Canada, I said, you all want to see, particularly in Muslim countries, a striving, mature democracy. But other than just giving lectures, nothing is done. Why can't you look at the essentials, how to strengthen the institutions, judiciary, free media, parliamentary reform, and just assist and work together? It doesn't cost too much money, but it requires some expertise and a small amount of funds. And Malaysia has come to a stage we don't need, it's not foreign aid, we need investments. So the first is strengthening institutions, giving people some exposure, for training, for expertise, for understanding. Number two is to encourage investment. Investments means the countries, China takes a real strong measures. If they say Malaysia, that's okay. We'll promote, make sure that more investments can do it. But where to invest, what area is, of course, up to the companies. Similarly here, and particularly because United States is quite exceptional because you have this long tradition, some huge investments in the country. So if you say what else can be done, I would say number one, help assist in strengthening the institutions of democracy. It should not be just because Anwar and his cliques are in, therefore it's a democracy. The next day somebody comes and then democracy is out. We want that to be institutionalized. And in order to institutionalize democracy, the core institution of the government, democratic entity, must be fortified. And that can be done from the relative experience of these countries. Secondly, of course, business investments. And third, as you know, Malaysia has sent huge number of students here for exchanges, for training, for education. And that would, of course, continue. But, you know, in these days and age, there should be some reciprocal arrangement where some of the measure of support is given. I would certainly continue to say this to my colleagues in the administration.
We'll take a question from Zoom.
We'll take the next question from Kara Bala.
Thank you. Kara Tan Bala, Seven Pillars Institute, and an erstwhile Malaysian. Mr. Prime Minister, what is the fate of the NEP?
Now, this she's referring to the new economic policy introduced by the then Prime Minister Abdul Razak in 1971. At the time when this was after the May 13th tragedy, race riots, when the majority Malays feel that there is no significance and substantive returns for them after independence in 1957, and abject poverty, no proper schools. So he has embarked on this new economic policy to make sure that the Malays, through affirmative action and intervention, are given opportunities, both in terms of education and in business. And I think in those days, I was still a young student, I support, given the scenario then, which I think it is an imperative to ensure there's peace and confidence among the Malays. But as time goes by, it reminds me of one classic song. You remember? Remember that, Baiza? Okay. Casablanca, yes. Oh dear. Most of them are too young to understand. It's okay. I'm so disabled, I have not seen the movie.
I have seen it.
All right, as time goes by. But as time goes by, then you realize there are a lot of excesses too. Once the strength is social mobility, the poorest in the rural areas were given access to education. It's a splendid, brilliant move. So you have children of poor farmers now becoming doctors, teachers, engineers. Fair. But what are the excesses? The family of leaders and their cronies start being awarded massive contracts, free shares, and those excesses now has, of course, disturbed the core, because the non-Malays or would feel, say, look, you use these to say affirmative action, but actually you your family members and the cronies benefited immensely. So I, even prior to my position as Prime Minister, there have been some measures done to make some adjustments. But my policy was you should continue in part the Bumiputra agenda is not part of the economic policy anymore. It's an affirmative action to make sure that they don't feel marginalized, at the same time to be very mindful of the fact that the number of ethnic Chinese and more so the Indians and those in the tribals in the Sabah and Sarawak are given adequate attention, particularly those in the lower category. So I think with this policy, people can be more reassured. So don't think of NEP or our programs as part of the remnants of the NEP, but major adjustments. Need-based. But why do you need to use still the Bumiputra or Malay agenda? Because, I'm being pragmatic. A lot of Malays feel that they're marginalized. That's why you have this wave of reaction. Amazing. I mean, we're trying to help them, respective of race. But then they feel that since you don't mention the Malays, we feel then marginalized. So that is why I think we should use this, but to make sure that there's clarity in the policy, that not a single Malaysian, whether you are Malay or Chinese or Indian or Dayak or Kadazan, would feel marginalized, ignored, or left out.
Ken Roth, I'm now from Princeton. I want to ask about two issues of human rights. One is the Myanmar junta, where the 5-point consensus seems to have gone nowhere. And I understand the difficulty of getting ASEAN to achieve a consensus on anything, but could Malaysia, working with like-minded partners like the Philippines, Singapore, Indonesia, push harder on the junta? And then second, the Uyghurs in Xinjiang. A million have been detained to force them to abandon Islam, their culture, their language. 50 governments around the world have signed on to a statement of concern. No one from ASEAN did, particularly the Muslim majority, Malaysia and Indonesia, which have very important voices. So what could your government do to advance those two important issues?
I've come a long way, and why do you ask me difficult questions? All right, now Myanmar. Myanmar, we've taken a very strong stance. Malaysia is one probably the strongest. But to suggest that ASEAN is not successful, it's not truly correct. ASEAN, there's consensus in ASEAN is a 5-point consensus. And I think that was, I mean, my predecessor. I mean, I can't claim the credit. But then I would acknowledge that this is very important decision made, the consensus made. And they consistently done that, with or without the military junta support. Now, secondly, ASEAN has taken a very bold measure because they are supposed to chair ASEAN 2026. But the consensus was no, we will not accept ASEAN in Myanmar to do that. So we have backpassed. But it's a very clear message. And in every meeting, almost in every single assembly. We took a very tough, not probably as expected by some countries, but very tough. I, for example, even say that probably, you know, the best way for ASEAN to manage now is to carve out Myanmar from the, otherwise in every session, we'll have to argue and nothing happens. I was a bit cynical even in the past when I said, they talk about constructive engagement, but end up with companies doing construction, no engagement. So we'll continue to do this. Of course, you are right. We are expected to do more because we cannot condone the atrocities. And we are suffering. I mentioned this to the Chinese leaders, to ASEAN leaders. I said, look, Malaysia has 200,000 refugees. It's growing and people is creating political anxiety at home. And the Myanmar authorities just ignore. And we can't send them back. They completely, the Myanmar authorities completely deny these guys, these people, 200,000 people as their citizens. Of course, majority of them are Rohingyas. Now, so secondly, the Uyghur. It's very controversial, very difficult, but ASEAN took this position that, look, whoever wants to engage, engage privately. I would say, I don't know about the other countries, but in my engagement, even with Foreign Minister Wang Yi, I did raise, I did ask about these issues. Some years back in the Washington Post, in the front page, there was an interview with me that makes some reference to this. What are the concerns? I think with the Chinese, I think it's a better way is, of course, for us as friends to discuss and let them explain. Of course, they will say this is an internal matter and it's not true, it's part of a Western propaganda. But I would say that I can't choose to ignore because this has been raised a couple of times and I did raise and they did explain. And they did welcome me or any of people on the team to go and have a visit, not necessarily manage or control or organized by the Chinese authorities. But of course, it is of concern, but our position right now is to continue to express in confidence in private, as I did with some of the leaders to show that these are issues of some, particularly even in Malaysia, many people have expressed, and I have to present this case to them.
Your voice and Malaysia's voice are very important on both of these issues. Yes.
Thank you. Jeff Laurenti, Minister Ibrahim, thank you very much for covering this waterfront. I have a question dealing with the waterfront on the East River, the UN, because other counterparts of yours, and I presume you yourself in your address to the UN General Assembly, will be giving enormous emphasis to the Sustainable Development Goals, midway through which promised period we are right now. But I would ask if you could help us walk through whether this is a conversation that exists anywhere outside of UN talking shops. That is, when you have ASEAN meetings, do folks talk about how we ASEAN members are making headway on or fulfilling our targets, our goals? To what extent, when the national government, your ministries, are putting together budgets, do they invoke the sustainable development goals that were decided on way off in New York as guides for where we need to invest money? And to what extent do those countries that, unlike Malaysia, are in a much more, how should I put it, needy state of development, turn to you, because you all have done very well in the developing world, for guidance on what works to achieve, whether it be gender equality or climate goals or whatever the 17 goals might be?
The SDG is considered and discussed extensively within ASEAN. Even in the last JICA meeting in Jakarta, we made reference to that with some specific programs and agenda. But for Malaysia, we even introduced last few months the National Energy Transition a plan, part of the SDG program in our economy. Madani is a major components of SDG being addressed. And I don't think we in the region take very lightly. But there are, of course, concerns. You know, we don't want this, you know, to be dictated by you know, the West to say, you know, to impose too many stringent conditions. Because if fair, you have cut all your trees and we have not to keep fair, but then this debate continues. The issue of carbon credit and how these states survive. Even in Malaysia, we took Malaysia. The government took a very tough stance. No more deforestation. But we have to deal with these provincial governments. They say, look, yes, there's the only revenue that we can get. And you say no. So we will have, the federal government, have to compensate them with some sort of carbon credit, whatever, or some reforestation program. So I think this is where the dialogue with the West, particularly with the richer countries and economies, have got to be more open, frank, because we need this better understanding. Okay, Malaysia probably is not as difficult as many other poorer countries, but still we face it because this is the stark reality. We said, yes, no more. This is the limit. No more deforestation. They say, fair, but you give us the money because there's the only revenue now. But these issues must be understood here and in the different world, in the more successful economies, to be able to contain this sort of policy or excesses. We need to also understand because these are real problems that we face. I mean, for Malaysia, okay, we see we can deal with it. But I think some countries may have worse problems than that. But as far as ASEAN, I have no choice. Not, again, I'm not claiming credit. I just joined. I've been probably in one or two meetings in the past. This is during chairmanship of Jakarta, President Jokowi. But thus far, in every single deliberation, SDG is put as a main, one of the main agenda.
Take a question from Zoom.
We'll take the next question from Raj Bala.
Thank you so much, Prime Minister. It's an honor to hear your remarks and to visit Malaysia many times. My question is about Malaysia's free trade agreement policy. Malaysia is, of course, a member of the CPTPP. Chapter 23 of CPTPP speaks about women's rights. And in a somewhat analogous chapter in the new NAFTA, to which, of course, Malaysia is not a party, there's also reference to the rights of people based on sexual orientation and gender identity. So the question is this: what is your view on what Malaysia's free trade agreement policy should be in advancing social justice, the rights of women and LGBTQ plus? And how does that view square with the views of some who take a different view according to Islamic law? And I should say I'm a law professor at the University of Kansas and teach international trade law and Islamic law. Thank you.
I think in terms of women's participation, there's no disagreement. Our policy, we have made clear pronouncements to increase the level of participation of women in the workforce, quite radical, we have announced. And of course, at home, I am in the minority. Other than my wife, I have 6 children, 5 are girls. So that have certainly some influence. But seriously, on the national position, I don't think it's even a contentious issue. The only question of criticism is how far is the government committed to enforce this and fast-tracking it and probably accelerating the process, which I think, to be fair, is basic issue of justice. And that has to be done. On the LGBT, you have to understand, I agree that people should not be harassed, but the consensus, Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, Christians, in Malaysia, the vast majority cannot accept the open display practice. And we have to respect that decision. It's a vast majority in Malaysia. In a democratic process, that is a stark reality. And it's just not, it's not true that you say this is Islam. I have engagements with the Christians, with the Buddhists, with the Hindus. That is the position that they take. And I think for government, we have to be mindful and sensitive to the demands of the majority, vast majority of our people. But where do I then caution is not to use our differences to excessively punish or harass innocent people. That is where we draw the line. You know, it's a very difficult issue to discuss in the United States.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister, for coming to CFR and speaking to us. And thank you, Mariko, for the opportunity to ask the question. I'm Zoe Liu, and I'm a fellow here at CFR. So my question really is about your recent revitalization of the idea of Asian Monetary Fund, which was first proposed during the Asian financial crisis in 1997. And at that time, also, you were nominated as the best finance minister during that time, a year before. So from your perspective, why do you think Asia now, or in the region, need a Asian Monetary Fund? And the last time when Japanese finance authorities introduced the idea, it was not quite as successful. And why do you think this time there is a chance? Thank you.
Look at Malaysia's experience now. As I've said, inflation, 2%, low unemployment, high investments, high or relatively high growth in difficult times, but declining value of the rate of the currency of the ringgit, just because of the decision here in the Fed. So it doesn't affect our fundamentals. However hard you work for a thriving economy, the ringgit is not influenced, is influenced by the decision here in the United States. So what do we do then? People talk of de-dollarization. It's not practical. I mean, the dollars will continue to be a major currency in international trade. We acknowledge that. But what can we do to redeem the impact that's adversely affecting our economy? Yeah. It's, for example, within ASEAN, we've encouraged strongly to use our local currency in trade. Or no, not possible. 20%, 30%, or like we with the renminbi, with China, 20%. I think with China is about 20, right? So at least to the best of our capacity. And now, why? Just because of our imperative. There's no choice to survive, at least to keep the currency at the level that is normally acceptable. The only option is, of course, to start increasing our interest rate, which have also some ramifications to the economy, to the business community, probably the poorer elements. So we will have that to grapple with this sort of issue. Now, therefore, we say, why can't we in Asia talk in terms of a possibility of some sort of arrangement? We have the Chiang Mai initiative, which is partly resolving. Not a complete de-dollarization, because it doesn't seem to be economically feasible for now. But at least it would be able to contain the negative impact that we face and suffer, which and without any sort of a initiative to counter this, at least to an limited sense. So I then say, why don't we in Asia start talking about this and preparing at least to redeem part of the negative or adverse impact on the currency. The Chinese seems to be quite amenable to discuss, and ASEAN too. But realistically, what we have done is to just make sure that there's this local currency arrangements through the central bank in a limited way.
Thank you, Prime Minister. Thank you for your excellent questions. Thank you for joining the session with the Prime Minister today. Please note that the video and transcript of this session will be posted on the CFR website. And we hope you'll be able to join the 5 p.m. hybrid event with Prime Minister Mohammed Shia Al-Sudani. And thank you very much, Prime Minister.